Well, hello, City Gators and friends. Great that you could join us for our online experience. If you're a guest here, a warm welcome to you as well. Thank you for joining us. Please let us know that you are with us by dropping a line in the comment field, maybe just your name, tell us where you're from, or leave us with a bit more info by clicking on the link that is on screen. There should also be a link in the comment field. We'd love to say hi and hear what your experience with us was like. As a City Gator, and even as a guest, you may have noticed that our announcements were only slides today. It's a little out of the ordinary. I know it's not normal, but hey, normal is a thing of the past anyway. But there is a reason why we've trivialized our welcome and announcements this morning. As many of you know, society is in a bit of a storm at the moment, in particular on this matter of racism and injustice against the black community. And as a church, we just want to take some time to address it. And as a guest today, you'll probably find our perspective interesting at the very least, but I trust it'll be beneficial to you at best. Also, I'm a white South African. Speaking into this context, I know it gives me a unique perspective because I grew up during apartheid and I came to faith in Jesus in my late teens as apartheid was on its last legs, and I kind of saw that played out into my mid-30s before moving to Canada, which is the second interesting thing. I'm not just white and South African, but I'm speaking to a Canadian context about a matter that is probably the loudest at this stage in America. And so those three things means that I'm not going to be perfect on this matter. I'm still learning. I'm a student of North American history. And so do extend grace to me as I continue to today. Having said all those things, I have the privilege of giving leadership to this church. And in light of what has gone down in the last 2 weeks, this is not the time to be silent or to be dismissive on this matter. Let's also not forget that we are in the middle of COVID-19, and those affected worst by the virus felt it in their respiratory systems. They needed ventilators to breathe. And I find that this strange parallel between that and the signs that are being held up saying, "I can't breathe," as a type of anthem that follows and followed George Floyd's tragic death. And for me, the sin of racism is like a deadly virus in our society, having a suffocating effect in particular on the black neighbors and friends and family. And as a church, we just want to say outright, we condemn racism in all of its forms. And we'll double click on all of its forms a little later. But before we move on, we also acknowledge as a church that before it's a political or an economical or a social issue, racism is a theological issue. Problem. It's a spiritual problem. And if our examination only stops at socioeconomic or political, at the political level, not finding the root of racism or the sin of racism in the depths of the human heart and the humanity's rebellion against God and against his creation, actually we are underestimating the depth of the problem. So as a church, hey, we may never stop addressing the sin of racism this side of heaven. Because it's part of the pervasive effects of the fall. Just as Cain killed Abel, I mean, it's his brother. This is one generation down from Adam and Eve. So we've seen over in history that people have hated each other, and often those hating moments have fallen along racial lines. But God, by his grace, through the gospel, he's the one who repairs this brokenness in society. And we as the church, we have a powerful basis, actually, for lasting love between different races. Now, I personally think our local church, City Gates, is an amazing testimony of that. And I love our community for that. And that basis is found in the realities of creation and redemption. Both of those we see in Scripture. Genesis 1, creation, that speaks about us being created in the image of God. When dignity is robbed from image bearers, we take responsibility. We rise up. We are not like Cain when God confronted him about Abel's death. He said, am I my brother's keeper? No, we follow Jesus in this matter. Jesus who said we should love our neighbor as we love ourselves. Our neighbor that's created in the image of God. And God asks of his people in Micah 6 verse 8. He says, I want you to love mercy, but first do justice. And then love mercy and kindness, another translation, and then walk humbly with him. And for us, we know that black lives are valuable because they're created in the image of God. But in particular, they're also vulnerable. And so we care about them standing and speaking with them against these injustices, helping defend and joining in on their plea. And so the first basis is creation. The second one is redemption. And the healing for this matter is at the heart of the gospel, because the gospel tells us that God not only reconciled us to himself through what Jesus did on the cross, but also reconciled us to one another. Jesus broke down the dividing walls of hostility between humans. We learned that in our series in Ephesians chapter 2 verse 14. And the early church experienced racism much like we are experiencing it, because Jews were at that stage holding Gentiles at arm's length. And the answer to that segregation was the gospel. That's the example we see in the New Testament. And myself, I've seen racial reconciliation to an amazing extent. The 15 to 20 years prior to my move to Canada, I've seen that in South Africa. And I didn't see, and still, racism is not eradicated, but I have seen a glorious interruption of racism with the truth of the gospel over those years. And that is because redemption is actually en route to a destination. Centuries before Jesus, Abraham, who was this Arab that God promised the nations to, he said, you know, the nations will be blessed through you. And that is a promise that we look to still at the end of everything. At the end of the Bible, it tells us there will be this multi-ethnic, many languages, nations, tribes, and tongues before Jesus. That's incredible. We are working towards that final reality. And so racism for us is against the very identity of us as the people of God. So we have those two bases, and that must cause us to reflect. And maybe now I'm speaking mostly to my white friends. You know, Micah 6 said we should walk humbly with our God. And to walk humbly is possibly to be open to the presence of racism in our own hearts. It means that we have to be open to maybe seeing the privileges that comes with the color of our skin. As a white South African, again, I've lived through apartheid, and I remember when a new government, or so a new system, was put in place. Did racism just go away in me because of a new system? No, it didn't. I needed Jesus. I still have to consciously fight against racism rising up in my heart, even in its smallest and forms. And I'm so grateful for the Holy Spirit that helps me as my conscience and brings those moments to light. And I'm grateful for the gospel, which is the story of Jesus dying for a sinner like me. It provides the perfect context for me to be open about my sin, because he bore the shame of that and took the penalty of it. And so when I do admit racism in my own heart, Jesus comes and he uproots that. That's what he does with sin. He deals with the seed of sin. Otherwise, we just mess with the fruit and we don't get to the root. Because this, here's the thing, racism isn't always overt like hatred that's easy to spot, but it can be more covert in nature oftentimes. Sometimes it's just shown in our preferences or just the indifference that we may have. And the gospel actually frees us from that position of pride and prejudice. Being prejudiced, and it causes us to be humble and have humility to say, yeah, you know, maybe racism is evident in my humor, the jokes that I laugh at, or when it comes to who I ultimately trust, racism rears its head, or maybe the preference of the neighborhood that I want to live in, or how do I feel when my children have black friends or romantic relationships with people of a different race. And so as we reflect on these things in our own hearts, it must move us then to empathy. as we live out our friendship, and let me dare say our family, as believers, you know, with our black neighbors, let us be attentive and empathetic, as someone said. Not just have a sort of surfacey thing going on where a mere acquaintance with someone is like a notch on our belt saying, yeah, I've got friends. I'm not talking about Facebook friends. Allow me to use the phrase friendship that gets in under their skin. Their life experience, that's what you need to know. This has helped me so much as a white South African with my black friends. And you'd be surprised as a white individual just how different your life experience might be to a person with a different skin color, even though you may live in the same context. And so let's be empathetic, let's listen, let's learn. And that would move us to, I believe, lamenting. Lamenting is a biblical phrase, it's a prayer discipline, where when we lament, we mourn the status quo. We admit things like, can you believe that in our day, unfortunately, there is still a system that to some extent enable and maybe empower racists to act on their fear or act on their hatred? And that is just not okay. We lament that reality. It's us saying, God, why? God, how long is this going to happen? We lament by identifying with that brokenness and feeling the pain of it. You know, I was watching a local news a station interviewing an American social or cultural commentator. It was a black woman. And when the news anchor asked her if she thinks that there will be any change, I was so saddened by her response because she said, no, I don't think so. And that for me is a hopelessness that I do not want to settle for. The scriptures does not give us permission to settle for that. God heard Abel's blood cry out against Cain's murder. God heard that. God heard Israel's plea when that nation was trapped in slavery in Egypt. And God will hear our plea as we lament. The Psalms of Lament often, if not always, reference God's character in the midst of that pain, references God's faithfulness in the past, and it trusts in salvation. And so it is with us. And so I would love for us to respond right now in song, in a way that is similar to lamenting, where we mourn the issue at hand and we cry out to God for change. Won't you join me as we sing together? Love wider than horizons. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the reconciling work of the gospel in our lives, that we are brought near to you, and as a consequence, we are brought nearer to one another, nations, tribes, and tongues, different ethnicities, together under the banner of Jesus. We acknowledge that the gospel and the church and your plan for us is the ultimate hope for humanity. And so will you help us as your people to live this out in a profound and visible way in front of a watching world. In Jesus' name. Thank you so much for singing along. I trust God met with you as you not only listened to what we've had to say on this matter, but also lamented and opened up your heart to the Holy Spirit working in you. And ultimately to empower you to be a part of the solution in this world today. And we are going to move into the next section of our service online. Do check out our announcements on our website and our social media channels, and at the end of the stream there'll be a few slides as well. They are important to some extent. But I'm going to hand over to Ryan in a moment. Ryan is an old friend of City Gates, and I'll let him introduce himself to you. But I want you to hear from him what an amazing community you are as a church. and be encouraged by that, and just know that God is working through you as his people. And then we'll move into a time of singing together, and then we'll hand over to Toby, who will be preaching the scriptures today. So over to Ryan.
Hey, City Gates family. It's Ryan Legg. For those of you who don't know me, I am a City Gates family member who was formerly a ways away out in the land of British Columbia. I was in Vancouver studying theology at a place called Regent College. And just a few weeks ago, I arrived back in Ontario. And even despite the circumstances, I'm really glad to be back. I miss all of you dearly. And Vic asked me to share a quick video just to sort of encourage you during this time. Our community was just huge for me, both during the year and before, and just in sending me off. And there was a moment right before I left where I was invited to come to the front at church on a Sunday morning, and a number of you came and prayed for me. And if I look back on my year, I could trace my entire experience through the themes that came up that morning in that prayer time. And I just want to encourage you, because God has done so many things in my life through the words that were spoken over me and prophesied over me during that prayer time that morning. Sonia, you, I think, were the first person to pray for me. You prayed about relationships for me. You prayed that I would have, you prophesied that I would have a band of fellows, I think was the phrase that you used, that would come around me and just be present with me to sort of weather and really flourish, actually, just throughout the whole experience. That came true actually on my first day I showed up in Vancouver. Sometimes it takes a little while to make relationships. That totally didn't happen for me. I literally got invited to the beach by some friends first day, and those people became really close and really helped me navigate sort of the bumpy and great ride that it was. Mike and Vic, you prayed that I would remember that theology is for Jesus's people. It's for the church. It's for it's for everyone. It's not just for theologians. And that was just huge in terms of the way that I approach my studies, the way I approach my classes, and that was incredibly grounding for me. The Holy Spirit just drilled that into me through that prayer time. Brian, you prayed that I would remember my identity. That was absolutely huge for me, that I would remember that I'm not Ryan from Oshawa or Ryan from City Gates, but that I would remember that I'm Ryan, God's son. And I think I learned things over these last 10 months or so that will shape me, and I'll be taking things out of that for my entire life. And then Edwina, you prayed for me about openness to next steps and new directions. And I just have to say, I have never felt clearer, I think, about life direction, or at least definitely not in the last 10 years or so. And all of that came into my life, but it was predicted and pointed out and prayed into my life before I even entered the experience. And that's because of you, because of God's Holy Spirit working in our community. And so I just want to encourage all of you, even in this season when we are stuck in our homes and we're distant physically from one another, let's remember two things. First thing, this is a unique opportunity to press into relationship with God, to pray, to ask him to be present and to cultivate in us spiritual gifts for us to use now during this time so that we can navigate it well as we just do all the normal stuff, taking care of kids and doing work and all of those things. But then also for what he wants to do when we're out of being stuck in this COVID season. And that comes from drawing close to God. So let's keep at that. Let's dive into our prayer lives. Prayer is a hard thing for most of us, and this is an opportunity to really lean into that. Second, even though we're physically distant from one another, let's not actually be socially distant from one another. There's a lot of opportunities for us, even during this time, to still be connected, to be a part of small groups on Zoom calls, and be a part of the prayer night on Monday nights. And let's stick together. When we are together and connected, God shows up in crazy ways. So let's remember that as we continue to weather this time in the season. I miss you all like crazy. I'm so excited to when I can see you and be with you in person. And I'm excited to worship with you this Sunday morning. Love you tons, and God bless you all.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Toby, and it is great to be with you. I'm going to be leading our time in the next few moments as we look at the Word of God together. Just a few things before we jump into that. As you know, it's June, and actually you might have had on your calendars that it is June 7th, that we should have been or would have been on our annual church retreat. Obviously, we are not there for a good reason. Hopefully, that can happen in the future. Right now, just as we look at the end of, we're at the end of the book of Ephesians, we're actually going to take the next 3 weeks or so to slowly kind of finish off in this letter that Paul writes to this church, and I hope that it continues to be helpful to you. Now, having said that, as we look at the end of chapter 6, our topic today is the devil. Yeah, real simple, you know, nice, easy topic, the devil, spiritual warfare, things like that. Before you tune out, right? You're reaching for wherever that close tab button is. Before you do that, give me a few moments to suggest to you that this is a relevant topic for you if you are a City Gator, if you follow Jesus, or if you're not, you're kind of checking us out online and you're wondering about what God and Christianity is all about. This is worthwhile paying attention for two problems that I see that we have. And the first is that we increasingly have no language for evil. We increasingly have no language for evil, and it doesn't take a lot for us to look out into the world and say, wow, something is deeply wrong. There is actually evil in the world. And I hope that's the case. I hope you're looking out in the world as we still remember and recall perhaps those images you've seen of George Floyd and his death and just the repercussions of that. And this is an issue that we need to look straight in the face. There is something wrong. There are voices all around the world saying something is wrong. And yet, I want to suggest to you that our collective language, and I'm speaking more to our Western collective experience, says that, well, everything is, you know, relative to you. You can decide what's right and wrong. And yet today we cry out, no, there's something fundamentally wrong about what's happening. This is how one scholar, his name's Andrew Del Banco, writing just about the idea of evil itself. He writes this in his book, The Death of Satan, How Americans Have Lost the sense of evil. He says, "So the work of the devil is everywhere, but no one knows where to find him. We live in the most brutal century of human history, but instead of stepping forward to take the credit, he has rendered himself invisible. Yet, something that feels like this force still invades our experience, and we still discover in ourselves the capacity to inflict it on others. Since this is true, we have an inescapable problem. We feel something that our culture no longer gives us the vocabulary to express. We've lost our ability to speak of evil, even as we look out into our screens and see violence and evil, and as we are all more open and aware of systemic discrimination and racism, we have lost our capacity to call out evil. And that is in part because our general philosophy and worldview is, well, morality is relative. You know, we've all evolved from a single cell organism, and it's actually very difficult. We cannot stand on that base and call out what is wrong, even though collectively our society knows it. And that's because the Judeo-Christian worldview says we're actually made in the image of God. We have value and dignity. That is the starting point from which we can say discrimination is wrong, so forth is wrong. And so we've lost our language, our ability to speak of it. But I want to invite you, even as we talk about spiritual forces and evil, that all fits into this matrix. Because if there is a God, if there is a good spiritual being, then wouldn't it also be possible that there were evil spiritual beings at work and in play? So that's problem number one. Problem number two. This is more for our for those of you who follow Jesus, and maybe this might help you. This is a quote from Michael Scott of Dunder Mifflin Paper Company. He says,
"I'm not superstitious, but I am a little stitious."
That is to say, many of us, again, in this context of Western progress, we have technology, we're progressive, we can explain things. And yet, over and over in the Gospels, the testimony of Jesus' life, he is encountering evil spirits, he is tempted by Satan himself, and he's constantly running up against spiritual beings. And it's easy for us to simply say, well, that person had schizophrenia, or, you know, had something wrong for lunch. And yet it's not so easy to do that. He encountered spiritual forces. And just to note, the majority of the world, and where the majority of Christians are throughout South America, Africa, and Asia, they have absolutely no problem reading what Jesus has done by conquering the power of death and evil. We tend to gloss over it. They, on the other hand, are very much aware of it and very, very open to it. And so we need to be aware, as we look at this idea of spiritual warfare and the devil, that perhaps our biases are from our lived experience here. So having said that, just those two problems that may be barriers for us to engage, I want to invite you, because we're just going to look at three verses. This is chapter 6, verse 11 to 12, and we're going to touch on 13 and 14 just a little bit. But I just want to look under three different headings. And the first one is simply this: it's not a fair fight. As we talk about spiritual warfare, it is not a fair fight. Verse 10 says this: "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might." Safe to say, this is not a 50-50 chance. We see over the Bible, as you know, Satan, or this evil presence, makes himself known to God. He's asking for permission. He's a created being. He's not on par with God. And it says, Paul, as he's completing this letter, he says, "Finally, be strong in the strength of his might." And that really brings us back all the way to the first chapter of Ephesians. Here is God's strength. Here is God's might. Verse 19 to 21. "And what is the immeasurable greatness of his power towards us to believe, speaking of Jesus, according to the working of his great might that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places. Far above, now know what he says here, far above all rule and authority and power and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. God's strength is ultimately manifested in the raising of Jesus Christ from the dead. This is the strength of his might. And this is the power that we're asked to be clothed in. And he's going to get into specifics. If you've heard of putting on the armor of God, we're going to cover that in the next few weeks. The armor, we are told specific to be strong in the Lord. It's a sense of being strengthened. It's not you are strong. It's actually to be strengthened from outside of you. My kids have these rope Legos. Have you seen these Lego people? This happens to be Lego Iron Man. And if you know these Lego people, they're not very dynamic. They move at the shoulder like so, and likewise at the hip. Okay, in and of themselves, they're actually not very fun. However, they got those Lego people, right? They're really smart. You put this Lego guy in this mech, I just broke it, this mech suit, and boom, look, he sits in here, you close the hatch, and all of a sudden, he's dynamic, his limbs move, his arms move, he has these weapons, and I imagine this is the sense of what it means to be strengthened by God. You know, on our own, we're not dynamic, we're not powerful. But by putting on God's armor, by being strengthened in him, we get to participate in this battle with his power. It's not a fair fight. Moving on. Secondly, put on the whole armor of God. We just looked at that. That you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. That word schemes, underneath that Greek word, has to do with method. The devil, he's over the course of the Bible, he's called devil, the Satan. He's a liar, he's an accuser, he's an adversary, he's against us. And listen, though it's not a fair fight, he does have great power. Listen to how one commentator writes it. He has great power, power over nature, power over animals, access to the heart of man. He can blind the mind. He can sow doubts. He spreads the spirit of fear and can use false teachings. He attacks us with evil thoughts, with depression, discouragement, resentment, with pride. I had one preacher use this illustration. He says, imagine you open up a piano and you sing a note into the piano, and you may not know what note you're singing, but actually the particular string, the frequency which you are singing, it starts to vibrate and reverberate. And he says the devil's like that. He can sing, he can pitch into our hearts, he can push us where we are weak, he can tempt us, he knows us. And maybe even during this time where we've been in lockdown, and we hear the stats, marriages are struggling, there's overdose, there's addiction, maybe even in these moments you feel your heart being sung to in a negative way, you are being pushed and tempted. This is what Satan and this is what this evil power can do. He can scheme, he can plot, he is against us. And then specifically, Paul, notice he says that we wrestle. Moving on, verse 12, we wrestle. And it's interesting, because otherwise we're in this kind of army, armor, battle imagery. But for a moment, he picks a very specific word that means wrestle. We struggle. This is like hand-to-hand combat. It's close. It's bloody. It's sweaty. It's wrestling with this power. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. And that term flesh and blood is an idiom for humanity. he's not saying, well, we just kind of step away from the word. Paul wrestled against flesh and blood. He was arrested. He was in the courts. He was shipwrecked. I mean, he was absolutely present, and yet he was aware that what he saw was not the battle alone. There is a cosmic battle beyond what we can see that is happening. And Paul says, this is how we're engaged. This is where we are engaged. Yes, the fight is not fair. Yes, the victory for sure is to be won, but it is a real battle, and the devil has his schemes and his methods. Finally, he says this, what are we to do? Stand, and stand some more. He says, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand firm. And then verse 14 adds, stand therefore. It is very clear what Paul is asking this church in Ephesus, and what he's asking us to do today. It is to stand firm. Now, what does he mean by that? Three things. First of all, I think it means to stand in what already has been won. Jesus has won the victory, and we are to stand our ground. We are to stand in the good news of the gospel. What does that look like? Little shameless quarantine plug. Something that we bought and decided to learn how to do. And I've learned how to do this. The kids keep messing it up, but I've learned that, what it's quite simple. You memorize some algorithms, they call it, and it's frustrating at first, but then you just keep repeating, and you make mistakes, and you repeat, and suddenly your hands get used to these motions, and then in a few minutes it's solved. When we stand in the gospel, it means we are retelling the story to ourselves. We are reapplying the good news of what Jesus has won on the cross through his life, his death, his resurrection. We retell it to ourselves. And I'm constantly reminded that you do not have to be a preacher to preach to your own heart. When we stand in the gospel, we are reminding ourselves. When we feel jealous, when we feel slighted, when we feel rejected, we look at the cross and say, wow, God loved me so much that he would die for me. Why would I be jealous? Why would the rejection of this thing break me when I know I have the love of the Father through his Son? We retell the gospel over and over again. We stand in it. Secondly, we stand against facing forward. The commentators make note that, Paul was in prison at this time, and probably he was, chained, and he had in view these Roman soldiers. And we know from a lot of history and reliefs and things like that, this armor was for front facing, right? There was no armor on the back. It was not armor so that you could run. It was armor so that you could stand and face forward. We stand up and stand against what is wrong. We stand up in prayer. During this time, as you might know, sports have been off, and they're freaking their way out. How are they going to get sports on again? During this time, the church has not been off. We didn't just shut off, and certainly the enemy has not shut off. We continue to stand. We continue to fight. We continue to engage in scripture, in your personal reading and prayer. We continue to pray together as a community every 2 weeks. We continue to gather in our groups. We continue not to let go of community. We continue onward because we are to stand. We are to stand and face what is coming. Finally, and I've just mentioned this, we stand together. There's much written about these legions, these battalions of Roman soldiers who would go in this kind of, they called it this tortoise formation, where they could use their shields as they, stand beside each other side by side, and they would use their shield, and it would stack, and they would be able to protect themselves and stand their ground against arrows, against attack, and they could only do that standing together. This was not like an individual thing where, you know, there are moving pieces. This is about being and standing together, and likewise, we are to continue to stand together. As some of us battle in warfare at various degrees, as some of us battle sickness or depression, as we battle the daily pressures of life, we can do that by standing together. Last thing, this is a lion, and this is for those of you under 20, let's say. This is a These are compact discs, actually. Yep, and they come in, this comes in a pretty package like this. You can put in your back pocket anytime. Our family loves to listen to these series of books that are recorded here, series of seven books, the protagonist is this lion. His name is Aslan. And certainly he is the protagonist. He makes the story go, and it's written by C.S. Lewis, a Christian author. Aslan is clearly a Christ figure, and he moves the story forward as these children come into this world of Narnia, and they go through all these adventures. As we're listening to the stories, it occurred to me one day, not long ago, like, Aslan, why don't you just solve the problem? I mean, why bring these children from this world, and so they have to go on these ventures, and they make these mistakes, and they're full of pride or anger or jealousy or a lack of faith. And in my mind, I'm thinking, Aslan, why don't you just do it? Solve the problem. Defeat the witch. Kill the king. Why not? And the obvious answer to the story is, well, there would be no story. There would be no Lucy and James and all. There would be no story to tell. And I think maybe that's also true of where we find ourselves. Because it's easy to think, man, Jesus, why don't you just come down here and solve, just solve the, just please. Would you please come and solve this problem? And yet, because he is good, because he loves us, and we can trust him, because of what he has accomplished and done through the cross, we can know that part of what we are battling through, part of the warfare that we are engaged in, is actually ultimately for our good. It's for our story. It's for our growth. And we can stand and trust him. Even as we engage and think about things that maybe scare us, we can do that together and know that this is ultimately for our good and for his glory.
We could ever breathe. She